Welcome friends to this Ind-AS knowledge series video number 17. Today we will be discussing Ind-AS 29, which is on financial reporting in hyperinflationary economies. If a reporting entity has made an investment in another entity which is operating in a country where the inflation is very high, we should use the word hyperinflation. And accordingly, when we are restating the financial statement, in accordance with the normal rate may not be the correct method of doing it. Similarly, if the reporting entity itself is operating in hyperinflationary economy, if we are considering the historical cost accounting, that may not be proper because of the change in the value of money because of the hyperinflation. So this standard guides how it should be translated in accordance with Ind AS 29. Okay. With this, let us move on to this standard. We will try to understand what is the scope of the standard, when the standard has to be applied, that we will see. What are all the indicators that a country is operating in a hyperinflationary economy? If it is operating in hyperinflationary economy, what is the core principles given in this standard for the purposes of recognizing the assets and liabilities, income and expenditure in accordance with this standard? What I have done is the entire prescription given in this standard has been made in 8 possible steps. I split that into 8 possible steps. And if we able to understand that 8 steps, understanding of Ind AS 29 is also simple. Okay. So with that, we will move on to what this standard is talking about. What is the scope of this standard? The standard is applicable to the standalone financial statement of an entity which is operating in a hyperinflationary economy, as well as an entity prepares a consolidated financial statement. It has investments in another entity which is operating in a country where the inflation is hyper. How to prepare the consolidated financial statement? The guidance is there. And where it says that this is applicable where the functional currency is the currency of a country where the economy is hyperinflationary. So where you know that under Ind AS 21, we have determined how the functional currency is being considered. A functional currency is nothing but the currency in which the major economic activities of the entity is being carried out. So suppose if the functional currency of a particular entity is a currency of a hyperinflationary economy, then how to apply Ind AS 29 for preparation of the financial statement for standalone purposes as well as for consolidated financial statement purposes along with its parent company, or how it will consolidate its subsidiaries, etc. Okay, this is what is the requirement. So when we are talking about hyperinflation, at what rate we have to consider that the inflation rate has moved towards hyperinflation, and what is the normal inflation? So at what point of time or what rate at which the hyperinflation is deemed to triggered is what we have to understand. The standard says there is no absolute rate, or I should not say the standard says we should not say that there is an absolute rate up to which it is operating in normal inflationary economy. If it crosses that threshold limit, it should be considered as operating in a hyperinflationary economy. So we should not put a specific absolute rate. If you are putting that, it becomes a rule-based standard, whereas the principles which we are following is under Ind AS is nothing but the principles rather than a rule. So accordingly, what it says is that you cannot assign a particular absolute rate as a rate at which the triggering of hyperinflationary happens. It simply says it's a matter of judgment, depending upon the facts and circumstances of the case and all other indicators which are prevailing according to the guidelines given in this particular standard. Actually, it says that hyperinflation is indicated by the characteristics of the country, the economic environment of the country. It is not a particular rate for this entity, which is in the, which has a functional currency, which is a currency of a hyperinflationary economy. What it actually says is that it is an economic environment of a country. That is what indicating the characteristics that the country itself is operating in a hyperinflationary economy. And accordingly, a particular rate cannot be assigned, that this is the point at which hyperinflation starts. So that's what the standard prescribes. The standard says, when you are applying this Ind AS 29 to the financial statement, it should be applied from the beginning of the reporting period in which it has identified the existence of a hyperinflation. So it is not on the end of the period. If you have identified that a country has now operating in a hyperinflationary economy, then this standard should be applied to the financial statement prepared by the entity which has that country's currency as the functional currency right from beginning of the reporting period, not at the end of the reporting period. Right from the beginning of the reporting period, it should be applied. What does it mean by beginning of the reporting period? We will see in the slides to come. So what is indicator of hyperinflationary economy? Because that is a triggering point which we have set. We should understand what is mean or what is the indications or what is the alerts which are coming into us, so that we have to classify that the functional currency of a particular country is operating in a hyperinflationary economy. To that extent, Ind AS 29 will be applied. That is what we are supposed to see. Now, what it says is that the population of that particular country keeps the wealth in non-monetary asset, not in actual cash and cash equivalent, or not in monetary asset, which are convertible into cash, because they believe that on conversion, because of the hyperinflation, we will lose heavily. So that is the reason why they are trying to manage the entire wealth in a non-monetary asset, maybe a property, plant and equipment. Or instead of keeping the wealth, they are keeping that in a relatable or relatively stable foreign currency. For example, if I am operating in Argentina and I wanted to retain the entire wealth in US dollar or euro, they believe that that is a more stable foreign currency if they are maintaining their wealth in that, either in non-monetary asset or in another relatively stable foreign currency. That is one indicator. The second indicator says, whatever local currency which I am having, if I am operating in a hyperinflationary economy, I immediately invest to maintain the purchasing power. If I am retaining that with me, the purchasing power on a future period will be lower. So immediately the currency which I am holding in the hyperinflationary economy is deployed to ensure that I am managing the purchasing power. So second indication. The third indications are not quoted based on the currency of that country. It is actually quoted in a currency which is relatively stable foreign currency. Maybe the transactions are entered into or denominated in euro or US dollar or Japanese yen. where that particular country believes that it is more stable foreign currency rather than the currency which is functional currency. And the cumulative inflation rate of that country over the last 3 years, either approaching 100% or exceeds 100%. So last 3 years cumulative inflation rate, which I have to start working out. We have some working to understand how it works. Say, for example, if I'm talking about 100 is the starting point, and inflation is happening at 20% every year, then I have to consider 100 plus 20% for the first year, 120 plus 20% for the second year, 144 plus 20 for the third year. So what is the cumulative inflation rate? Is 144. It crosses or nearing that level. That's what we are trying to understand, what is the inflation rate which operates. Suppose if we are saying that the interest rate, wages and prices are not based on the functional currency of that country, rather than they are linked to a price index. For example, if I'm saying the price today in respect of my selling price for a product is say 100, but I'm linking that in case if the inflation moves below so much of percentage, what would be the selling price? If the inflation goes up based on certain percentage, what would be the revised selling price? If I am fixing an index for, not necessarily for the selling price, even for the wages, even for the borrowing cost, if that all set based on a particular price index, then that is also indicating that the country is operating in a hyperinflationary economy. So if any transaction is happening, even for purchase of a non-monetary item, the transactions are priced in such a way that if there is a loss of purchasing power due to inflation in the index, whatever loss which will be incurred by the buyer or the seller, if it is agreed to be compensated by means of an agreement for every transaction, that is also an indication that the buyer and seller are anticipating that the inflation will be in the hyperinflationary economy, and to that extent, the prices, the current market prices are not reliable or stable, and accordingly, any future losses should be taken into consideration in respect of loss of purchase power. So these are all the indicators that a country is operating in hyperinflationary economy. If you have identified that the country's economic environment is operating in a hyperinflationary economy, then the functional currency of that country is considered to be in having the impact of the hyperinflation economy. So to that extent, whether it is correct to prepare on the functional currency basis or based on some other rate is what this standard is talking about. Let's go further. One list has been published in 21st May 2019. That's what the latest data I could Google out and got. This is documented based on International Practices Task Force Committee meeting. So this Task Force Committee meeting held in May 2019 discussed the hyperinflationary economy based on the inflation which is happening in various countries which were on the watch list, and set or come out with a list of countries which are operating in hyperinflationary economy. So the update may happen in the current year. So up to that point of time, let us understand what are all the countries which are operating in hyperinflationary economy. Countries with 3-year cumulative inflation rates which has exceeded 100%. Angola, Argentina, Congo, Sudan, Venezuela, all these countries, the inflation in the last 3 years cumulatively exceeded 100%. So accordingly, if any entity is operating in Argentina or Sudan or Venezuela, should prepare the financial statement as per Ind AS 29. Similarly, any investment made by an Indian entity into an Argentina entity or in a Congo entity or Sudan entity should also restate that financial statement in accordance with the hyperinflationary economy conditions as per Ind AS 29, and then the consolidation should happen. Otherwise, what we are stating may not be correct purchasing power of that particular asset or particular liability, and that is the reason why it is coming out with a separate standard prescribing the accounting treatment. So these are all the countries which has exceeded, based on the last 3 years cumulative inflation rate, 100%. These are the countries who are expected to reach, or there is a projection that they will also reach the cumulative inflation rate exceeding 100%, which is Republic of Iran, Yemen, and Zimbabwe. These three countries are projected to cross 100% high inflation rates, which is cumulative over the last 3 years. They have also come out with certain countries which are approaching towards that 100%. They are somewhere around 80% or 70%. Liberia and Libya. So why I am giving this list is, this is like a ready reckoner for anybody to see which investment should be restated in accordance with Ind AS 29. Okay, having seen this illustrative, this list as published by International Practices Task Force, let's move on. Let's look into the core principles of this standard. This standard shall be applied when the financial statements have been prepared based on historical cost approach, as well as when the financial statements have been prepared on current cost approach. In both the scenarios, restatement has to be done if the functional currency is the currency of a country which is operating in hyperinflationary economy. You have to use this particular standard. The standard also says that you cannot issue the restated financial statement as a supplement to the unrestated financial statement. Similarly, you cannot prepare and present a separate financial statement as per normal principles and also another restated financial statement. So you cannot issue a separate financial statement before a restatement. That is also discouraged. In simple terms, for a country which is operating in hyperinflationary economy, if the entity is having the functional currency of that particular country, it should only prepare a restated financial statement in accordance with Ind AS 29. That should be presented. When it is presented, suppose if I am using a situation where the entity is reporting entity is in India and one of its subsidiary is in a country where it is hyperinflationary economy. So, and the currency in which the financial statements have been prepared in that country is different from INR, which is their reporting currency or presentation currency of India. And India is operating in a non-hyperinflationary economy. So in that case, when you are using INR for converting the financials into the presentation currency, so to that extent, you should always use the closing rates. In Ind AS 21, when we discussed, we have discussed three situations, and the third situation is talking about when the entity presents the financial statement in a currency other than the functional currency. Then we said translation has to be done, and there are parameters which has been given. What are all the items which has to be translated, which rate? certain items in closing rate, certain items on the transaction rate, or certain items on the date on which fair valuation has been done, etc. But here it says that if the financial statement of the entity which you are translating to INR is operating in hyperinflationary economy, then you should only use the closing rate for restating all the entire financial statement into the presentation currency, which is INR. When you are doing it, this may be a situation where the current year is the hyperinflation and the previous year is not having any hyperinflation, and accordingly it says that do not restate the prior period items, only with respect to the presentation in a different currency other than the functional currency which is operating in a hyperinflationary economy. You need not restate the prior period items. Suppose if the functional currency itself is operating in a hyperinflationary economy, what are all the items which has to be restated? What it says is that restate the current reporting period financial statement, restate the comparative period financial statement, assuming that the hyperinflationary trends are existing even at that point of time, because we are talking about cumulative of 3 years, no? Naturally, it could be impacting the comparative period also. And also any information which is relating to prior period or earlier periods, not necessarily the comparative period, even before that, any information is there in the financial statement, but it is reported in a different currency other than the hyperinflationary economy currency, then we have to restate all the items, current period number, comparative period number, any other prior period information included in that financial statement should be restated as per Ind AS 29. Now, how the restatement has to be performed? We are talking about certain step-by-step process. One, you have to identify what is a general price index, maybe GPI, I can use it as an abbreviation. You have to identify what is the general price index. And then you have to restate the comparative financial information. You have to restate the current year historical cost financial statement. And suppose if the financial statements are prepared on a current cost, that should also be restated. Whatever resultant profit or gain or losses which is arising, that should be considered in respect of the restatement of net monetary position. So net monetary position, when I am saying monetary assets restated as per Ind AS 29, monetary liabilities are restated as per Ind AS 29, what is the net position? The net position could be a loss or gain, and that should be accounted in the financial statements. What are all the other practical implications which may arise? For example, impairment testing may be required. It may result in a temporary difference, and to that extent, Ind AS 12 should be applied. So we have to consider the other practical implications as well. There is a possibility that previously the economy in which the country is operating or the entity is operating is hyperinflationary economy, but it ceased to operate in a hyperinflationary economy. What would be the revised accounting principle? Because previously we have done as per Ind AS 29, there should be a carrying amount for using other standards on the day it is coming out of the hyperinflationary economy. How that should be accounted for? What is the principle that we have to apply? And finally, we have to make the necessary disclosures as per the requirements of this particular standard. So there are 8 steps which you have to understand how the restatement as per Ind AS 29 should be done. Now, let us go step by step. Step 1, you have to identify the index to be used, right? So we are trying to find out what is the general price index. That is nothing but representing the price changes in a broad range of goods and services. What is the changes happening with respect to the goods and services? That is what we considered as a general price index. Or it may be a consumer price index rather than a wholesale price index. Assuming that the previous one is wholesale price index, but consumer price index could be different. That could be also a price index. Or if you ask, this could be a reliable general price index, which is available on a timely and consistent basis, and computed also on a consistent and accurate basis. So this is what you have to use it as your price index, or the general rate which you have to use for converting the financial statement in accordance with Ind AS 29. So if you see this, it is not talking about any particular rate or particular range as the hyperinflation. It is actually saying that what is the consistent purchase price, what is the consistent consumer price index, or what is the reliable price index, general price index, which will be available on a timely basis, on a consistent basis, which can be accurately applied with all qualitative factors, you arrive at what is the index rate. If that reliable general price index is not available, a substitute index can be used instead of a stable currency rate. So you have to identify what could be the substitute index more or less equivalent to this particular economy. What could be the source of the price index? Local sources could be the Ministry of Economics, Ministry of Statistics, even Ministry of Commerce, Reserve Bank of India, or in a different country, it could be the Central Bank of that particular country. Any other research publications which is available could be one of the source. If you are talking about international sources, it is International Monetary Fund, World Bank, and any other economist which are doing an intelligence or research activity which is publishing the type of information. This could be the local source or the international source from which you can identify what would be the appropriate price index to be applied in a hyperinflationary economy. How to calculate the price index? What it says that the price index should be calculated because we are talking about 3 years cumulative price index, which is approaching towards 100% or exceeds 100%, right? The cumulative price index has to be calculated on a compounded basis. What do you mean by compounded basis? You cannot simply apply, suppose if I'm saying first year 20%, second year 40%, third year 40%. So 100 into 20%, 120 into 40%. Sorry, 100 into 40% for second year, 100 into 40% for third year. That's a simple rate, right? So otherwise I can say 20% on which 40% is increasing, another 40% increasing. So I will apply on 100%. It's a simple rate. So it is not possible. You have to use a compounded basis. Let us take one simple example to understand. Suppose the three consecutive years, the inflation is 20%, 30% and 40%. What is the cumulative price index rate? The start year, the price index is considered as 100. The inflation is 20% in the first year. So the cumulative price index at the end of the first year will be 120. Second year, it is 120 into 130%. That is 30% increase, right? So 120 into 130% is 156. And in the third year, it is 40% on 156. That's the previous year's cumulative price index. What has happened on the third year on a cumulative basis? This has crossed 100%. 218, that means 100 is the base. 100 minus 218, 118 has increased. So once it has increased that level in the 3 year at an average, when we are seeing, it shows that the currency is operating in a hyperinflationary economy. You cannot apply this simple cumulative price index where 100% plus 20% plus 30% plus 40%, which is 190%, not possible. So because it gives only 190, and because if we apply the simple cumulative price index, you will have a feeling that it is not reaching towards 100%, approaching towards 100%, or it is exceeding 100%. So you will conclude wrongly that it is not operating in a hyperinflationary economy. So you should always look on a compounded basis. You must be clear on this concept. Let us move on to the next one. Okay. Step two. How I have to restate the comparative financial information. So the prior year financial information has to be restated. That's what we have said. Current year number, prior period number, that is a comparative period number, and any other earlier period numbers presented should be restated. How it has to be restated? Prior year figures into index of the current reporting period divided by the index of the prior reporting period. For example, in the previous one, we talked about 156 and 218, right? So in this case, if I am restating the comparative period, the index of the current period is 218 divided by the index of the prior period, which is 156, into what is the particular items carrying amount in the financial statement. Assuming that it is 200 into 218 divided by 156 will give you the restated number. This should be applied for all prior year balances except where it is relating to presentation currency is the currency of a non-hyperinflation economy. Only the current year number will be restated and the comparative should not be restated. This is what I have told you in the initial slide. When you are restating for the, if you are concluding that everything is operating in hyperinflationary economy, current year number, previous year number, earlier year numbers are restated. Whereas if you are preparing a financial statement translating from a functional currency, which is hyperinflationary economy currency, to a presentation currency, only the current year number should be restated. Previous comparative figure should be retained as it is. There could be two possibilities. One, previous year, the entity is not operating in hyperinflationary economy, and accordingly, you have not used Ind AS 29. So you are not doing anything with respect to the current period figures of the previous period, nothing but it comes as a comparative period. So when it is not applicable, you should not restate that number for the previous year. That could be one logic. The second logic could be, it is already restated with respect to the inflation rate of that particular year. For example, when I have applied this, we calculated 3 years, right? 218, 156, and we have also considered somewhere around 130 and for the first year. So suppose if I am doing the restatement for the comparatives in respect of the presentation currency in non-hyperinflationary economy, the comparative number has already been restated at 130 vis-a-vis 156. So index of the current period for the previous period will be 156 and the index of the prior period reporting period is 130. So it was already restated based on that proportion. So if I am again restating, that gives a wrong statement. That is the reason why, except in case where you are doing a conversion from functional currency to presentation currency and the presentation currency is a non-hyperinflationary economy, then you will retain the comparative number. If it is not non-hyperinflationary economy presentation currency, you will restate that number also. So that is what we have seen earlier. That comes very clearly here. Step 3, how we will restate the numbers, balance sheet numbers, how we will restate profit and loss account numbers, how we will restate, we will see in this particular process. What it says that balance sheet items other than specifically covered. There are certain items which are specifically covered and it prescribes certain accounting treatment. Other than those items, in simple terms, whatever I am going to discuss below, other than those items has to be applied based on general price index. Whatever we have calculated as the general price index, in this case, it's 218. On that basis, we have to convert. Monetary items. Whether I have to convert, no restatement, because all monetary items are normally presented based on what is the realizable value. For example, If I'm talking about trade receivable, I might have already done that. So I need not restate those numbers. No restatement is required. Suppose there are some assets which are index-linked assets and liabilities, options, forward contract. Those items should be adjusted because there is an index which has been done based on a contract. And what is the contractual terms? That rate should be applied because I'm not going to lose anything other than the forward contract rate. I have secured to that level or minimized or indemnified my losses, or I have hedged my losses to that extent. And accordingly, no further losses are expected, even if the inflation rate goes down. So accordingly, if there are some contractual terms and based on which there is an index-linked assets and liabilities are existing, restatement should be done based on the contracted rate and not based on the general price index. Non-monetary assets and liabilities. What we have to do? Suppose property, plant, equipment or any other non-monetary liability, how it has to be restated? If they are carried at current value, not to be restated. That is net realizable value in respect of inventories or fair value where you have considered with respect to an investment, etc. So if they are already carried at the current values, no restatement is required because it's already restated to the current figure. If you are trying to apply the general price index also, you will get the same result. So it should not be restated. Other than those items which are carried at current value, where it is already tested for current prices, you should not restate. Those items should not be restated. Any other items other than current value items should be restated using the general price index. So the moment I am saying a non-monetary assets and liabilities not carried at current value will also be going to the first category itself separately. There is no separate treatment required. Inventories of WIP and finished goods, it's not fully completed. Suppose there are something to be done. So they have to be restated from the date on which the cost of purchase and conversions were incurred. What is the date on which the conversion cost has started to be incurred? For example, the inventory has been held only for 9 months and I have to use only for the 9 months restated number, average rate, which I have to apply for the 9 months. I should not take it for 12 months. Okay. So this is the principle for balance sheet. Let's take some worked out example for us to understand this little further. Here we are giving the assets and liabilities in respect of ABC Limited, which is operating in a hyperinflationary economy. These numbers are prior to application of Ind AS 29. These financial positions have been given as of December 31, 2018, because it's operating in a foreign country. So the calendar year will be the accounting period. So these are given in lakhs. For our understanding, I'm taking it in lakhs. The property, plant and equipment was purchased on December 2015. Now we are talking about December 2018. So it is purchased in 2015, 16, 17, 18, 3 years. It is already depreciated. So it is purchased in 2015. And intangible assets and trademarks were purchased in 2016, and 60% of trade receivables were done on April 30, 2017. Inventory was held only for 9 months. Borrowings were raised on March 31, 2018. These are all additional information. So how we have to restate property, plant and equipment? What is the point which we have said? If it is a non-monetary asset, but they are not held at current cost, you should normally use to restate, use the GPIs to restate that numbers as per Ind AS 29. So that whether it will apply to property, plant, equipment in this case, yes, because they have not done any revaluation. Similarly, intangible assets is purchased in 2016, no adjustment has come. Trade receivable are taken in 2017 April. So whether anything to be done on that, we will see. What is the nature of trade receivable? Is a monetary asset. And inventory held for 9 months. So when we are restating, we have to identify what is the average increase for the 9 months period, and that should be used, not the closing rate. Borrowings has been taken on 31st March 2018. That is, it is also outstanding for 9 months. So how I have to restate? First, I have to calculate what is the general price index. Here in the problem, they have given 5 year number. So when I am having 2014, it is 100, 2015, it's 50%, and 2016, 90%, and 2017, 220, and 2018, 280. So principle is whether I have to apply Ind AS 29 or not. If the cumulative average price inflation is nearing to 100% or exceeded 100%, Ind AS 29 should be applied. In this case, what is happening was in 2016 itself, it is nearing, or 2017 it has 100% exceeded, and 2018 also it is 100% exceeded. So when we are talking about preparing the financial statement for March 2018, definitely this entity is in hyperinflationary economy. So accordingly, Ind AS 29 should be applied. So we have concluded that general price index should be used for doing the restatement. And let us see how the restatement should happen. So property, plant, equipment, what we are doing, we are taking 600, which is nothing but the carrying amount, and we are taking the increase in the inflation or restating the number using what is my original purchase index. It was purchased in 2015. So 600 divided by 150 into what is the current index, 280, that is applied. Similarly, I am using the same thing for intangible asset, because intangible asset was purchased when the index was 190. So divided by 190 and 280 current price index, it is multiplied and shown what is the number. Inventory has been done in a different manner. 1800. Where is the 265 is coming? I don't have any 265 here at all, but I have only 280. So what I am saying is that it is held for 9 months. So if it is 9 months, I cannot apply the full year inflation. I have to only restate to that extent of the average inflation which has happened. So average inflation we have to calculate. We assume that the inflation is happening on this uniform basis over the 12 months. If we assume, what will happen? I have the working here. 2018 number is 280 and 2017 number is 220. Increase is 60. That means 9 months increase is 60 divided by 12 into 9, which is 45. So index for inventories I am taking 220 plus 45, opening plus the other one, which I have taken for the purposes of restating. So you have to be careful when the problem starts giving you various years and various indexes. Use the appropriate index for restating. That is what we have said. You have to restate the numbers in accordance with basis, on the basis of the current index divided by, the numbers divided by the prior period index into current index. That's what we are supposed to do. That's what we are doing, that number, as far as the restatement is concerned. But trade receivable, as I said, it's a monetary item. Monetary items, trade receivable normally tested for expected credit losses. So it has been already brought down. So to that extent, there is no adjustment which is required. Cash is a monetary item, and to that extent, I need not do any adjustment. So this becomes the total of my assets. And what I do is, similarly, I restate my share capital, which was on the original date, 100. And then I'm restating that number. Retained earnings, I'm just leaving as it is, and I'm moving to borrowings. Borrowings is a monetary item, so accordingly no restatement is required. Trade payable is a monetary item, so no restatement is required. So I am adding up all these numbers and reducing from my net, my asset position. So 1960 is reduced from 5642.95 and then reduced by 250 and 1500. I get the balancing figure of 1932.95. So in simple terms, I'm restating the opening balances based on the index of that particular year with the closing rate of the current year, so that the comparative figures, this is an example of where the comparative figures are restated. Now I have restated the comparative periods. For example, in this case, no, the balancing figure retained earnings 1932.95, but actually it was 2500. So that means 2500 minus 1932.95. 2500 is the unrestated number minus the restated number, which is coming as this, is 567.05 is the loss arising out of restatement as per Ind AS 29, which is adjusted in the opening retained earnings, because it is the problem of converting opening balances, not closing balances, right? So if it is a closing balance, I will simply take 280 as the conversion rate for all these items, because it has to be done on the closing rate, right? Now we understood how we have to restate the opening balance. Now when we are coming to another example, I think this example is talking about restatement. Okay, here it is talking about a situation where the PPE is at a restated value. So how the restatement of the PPE can be done? Because when you are holding this, in the previous example, we have taken the entire thing into retained earnings. But strictly speaking, whatever is the restatement which I am doing with respect to PPE should get adjusted in the OCA, because any revaluation should be done in OCA, assuming that this is a closing figure which we are trying to do the adjustment. Okay, the information given only in respect of PPE, where gross value has been given, depreciation has been given, net value has been given in the currency unit. The currency unit is in the functional currency of the country in which hyperinflationary economy prevails. How this numbers has to be restated? What it says, you have to restate as per the closing rate. What is the closing rate which is given here? They are saying between 2016 to March 2019, the rate of inflation is observed to be equivalent to 100%. That means what? 2016 number, if it is 100, March 2019 will be 200. So accordingly, I am taking 200 to restate the carrying amount of gross value of 10 lakhs. The same logic, depreciation is also restated, net value is also restated. So what actually happens when I do this? This is more or less the principle of revaluation, and any increase in the value of a property, plant, equipment as per Ind AS 16 should be taken to OCI only, and the depreciation should be on the revised value. That's what Ind AS 16 says, and I should apply that particular standard as well. So how the entry should be passed? The gross carrying amount increases by 10 lakhs. That is, original carrying value this much, I am restating to 20 lakhs. It increases by 10 lakhs. I have to charge additional depreciation for the restated figure, because it increases by 10 lakhs. So for 10 years is the economic useful life which I have considered. So I have taken an additional depreciation. Initially, I have charged only 1 lakh rupees. So I have to charge by another 1 lakh rupees, which I have charged here. And this 11 lakhs has to be distributed to one component, the cumulative depreciation. Previously, it is 3 lakhs. Now it has to be made as 6 lakhs. that portion I have to take into consideration as a restatement of the accumulated depreciation as well. I have done that. And on the comprehensive income, 7 lakhs is the increase in the value of property, plant, equipment. So that should go to my other comprehensive income and not to P&L account. So to that extent, I am trying to identify what is the amount to has to go. That 7 lakhs has happened over a period of 2 years. Actually, this is 3-year period, out of which only 2 years period is hyperinflation. And before that, it is not in hyperinflation. So 2-year number has been taken to other comprehensive income. And because I have applied the Ind AS 29 restatement of general price index, the loss which I have to recognize in my P&L account comes to 3.3 lakhs. So 4.66 lakhs goes to other comprehensive income, and this has to go as a reversal, and profit is arising out of this restatement, 3.33 lakhs, which I have to take it to my profit and loss account. Okay, this is what the requirement which is actually happening when the net monetary position increases. If it is decreases, then the position is different. That will become a loss. Okay, this is what we are talking about, restatement of balance sheet items. Suppose if it is a property, plant, equipment which has been revalued, I have to start from the date of revaluation. That is the reason why when we calculate the difference, we have calculated only for 2 years and not for the full 3 years period. Assets acquired under deferred payment without incurring any explicit interest charge, you can compute the imputed amount of interest. If it is impracticable, you can restate from the payment date. Otherwise, you have to restate from the date on which it has been acquired. Owner's equity, except retained earnings and any revaluation surplus, you have to restate from the previous restatement of the date of contribution. Whatever is the date on which have you anything done, any change has been done from the previous restatement, or a date on which a contribution has been received, whichever is later. For example, in 2016, I got the initial share capital, and the restatement as per Ind AS 29 has been already done in 2018. I should not go back to 2016 and apply it. I have to start with 2018 because it is already restated. If the restatement has not happened, for the first time I am coming to the inflationary economy, I have to take from 2016. That's what we have done in the one of the example which we have seen. We took that as base as 100, okay, because we are saying that it was not restated before. So this restated amounts are compared with the recoverable amount, inventories, net realizable value, or market value of the current investment. In case if they have an excess, we will not do anything. If there is a shortfall, we will apply the corresponding standard. So corresponding standard could be Ind AS 2, or in respect of inventory, Ind AS 16, property, plant, equipment, current investment, Ind AS 109. What is the prescription given in that particular standard? You have to adjust in accordance with that. That is the reason why 2/3 of that number we have taken to OCI. The balance we have considered as a loss, profit arising out of restatement in the previous example. Now, how the P&L account items has to be restated? Incomes and expenses has to be restated using the general price index on the date when the items of income and expenditures are initially recorded. That is the date on which it was originally entered into, and the date on which it is, what is the reporting date? What is the rate on the reporting date? We have to apply the index changes. If you recollect, for inventory, I have applied similar scenario. At an average of 265 to 280, I have applied. The similar logic has to be applied for income and expenses from the date on which the transaction has happened, and what is the rate at the end of the period. You have to apply that proportion for the restatement of that number. You can also use an average monthly index if it approximates to the initial index of the initial date. That is, it's a similar principles like what we have seen in Ind AS 21. Suppose if the financial statements, whatever we have seen is restatement of balance sheet items and profit and loss account items relating to financial statement prepared on historical cost basis. Suppose if they have been prepared under current cost basis, what is the treatment? Balance sheet has to be restated. If the items have been already stated and current cost, I should not restate it because it's already measured. All other items has to be restated according to Ind AS 29 because it's already current cost has been applied for many of the items. So to that extent, it is representing the purchasing power. So you need not restate any other item which is not restated according to the current cost assumption or held at historical cost. Those items has to be restated according to this standard. Profit and loss account. At the end of the restated into the measuring the unit current at the end of the reporting period by applying a general price index. If you see that if we are talking about a historical cost, we have took two rates. What is the date of transaction? Two year-end rate. That's the way in which we are trying to identify what is the rate to be applied for restatement. Whereas here, end rate or the closing rate of the general price index should be applied if it is done on a current cost basis. So all the income and expenditure should be made at the current level. So we are taking the closing rate. Logic is very simple. So what we have to do with the gain or loss? If the monetary liabilities are greater than monetary asset, gain on purchasing power. If the monetary liabilities are lower than the monetary asset, we are losing the purchasing power. So gain or loss should be recognized in the profit and loss account. What are all the other practical considerations which we have to apply? Statement of cash flows. We have to use the measuring unit current at the end of the reporting period. All items should be restated according to the closing rate. Income taxes, you have to apply. If there is any temporary differences arising out of the application of restatement, that will be tax deductible or taxable at the subsequent period. You have to apply the principles of deferred tax as per Ind AS 12. In consolidated financial statement, so in case if the financial statement of subsidiaries is also reported in the currencies of hyperinflationary economy, we have to restate them to the average or the general price index, and that should be used for the purposes of consolidation. Okay. Now, step 7. Previously, the entity was operating in hyperinflationary economy, so he almost brought everything into the closing rate or in proportion to the closing rate. Now it has ceased to be in hyperinflationary economy. It has revived. It came for a normal economy. In that case, whatever accounting treatment given under Ind AS 29 should be stopped. First principle. What we have to do with respect to the earlier restated number, discontinuation we have done, and whatever is the earlier restated number according to Ind AS 29 will become the carrying amount for the purposes of the subsequent financial statement. So the opening balance is nothing but whatever is the opening balance as per Ind AS 29, that should be treated, and you are not going back retrospectively and say that whatever losses which I have accounted for, I will reverse it. It is not possible. So you have to consider on the basis of the carrying amount as per the previous reporting period and take it in the subsequent financial period. Finally, what is the major disclosures which are required? It says the fact that the current period and corresponding figures have been restated due to the application of Ind AS 29, in case it has been done as per Ind AS 29. The financial statement which has been used is based on historical cost approach or current cost approach. You have to specify that. And what is the level of price index at the end of the reporting period and what is the movement in the index, how you have identified, what is the source of your identification should be disclosed, and how long the entity is operating in hyperinflationary situation should also be disclosed. Maybe for the last 3 years it is operating in hyperinflationary, last 2 years, only in the current year it has moved to hyperinflationary situation. Based on the economy, you have to disclose that factor as well, because the user will have a better idea with that particular information. And with that, I think we fairly covered the restatement requirement of Ind AS 29 when the entity is operating in a hyperinflationary economy or its investments are held in a country where it is operating in a hyperinflationary economy. We have seen how to identify the hyperinflationary economy. We have seen how to identify the general price index. And we have also seen how the balance sheet has to be restated, how the P&L has to be restated, how the revalued assets and liabilities should be restated, how the balance sheet or financial statement, which are prepared on current cost basis, should be restated, where the restatement differences has to be accounted for. All those items we have seen, and including the preparation of a cash flow statement, consolidated financial statement, as well as the impact of deferred taxes with respect to this. In case, if you are working out this, impairment has to be tested. That should also be part of this particular standards discussion. That's what it says. In one point of time, when I have restated all the numbers, I am trying to see what is the recoverable amount and what is the carrying amount, what is the prescription given in the relevant accounting standard. All those things we are considering, and we also make the relevant disclosures. So before we say goodbye for the session, I wish to thank all of you for your continuous feedback, continuous encouragement, and continuous touch with me with your queries and questions, asking for or seeking clarifications. I'm happy to that extent possible. Then and there, I'm responding in the YouTube channel itself for the benefit of the larger audience. So accordingly, be a subscriber to the YouTube channel and you will also see if there is any comment comes from any of the subscriber and I am responding to the comment, both you can actually see, and it will actually help you to understand whatever we have discussed at length, because some of the viewers are sending me excellent questions, pinpointing certain case studies which we have done, asking for an explanation of how that number has been arrived at, etc. So I am explaining that to them. In fact, certain cases, it is very lengthy question. So those lengthy questions I could not answer within the channel. I am keeping it as part of our Q&A session, which we are planning separately. And thank you so much. And until the next video, stay in your respective homes and stay safe. Goodbye.